their face walks through my mind. Usually their face walks through my mind and the Holy Ghost goes poof, and I'm like, ooh, okay. And I start praying. And when I pray for my saints, the same thing happens. A face walks through my mind, and I'm like, sick of Jesus, hallelujah. And I pray for my people, hallelujah. Amen. The Lord would like to lead you into the knowledge of the ministry of intercession.
Hallelujah.
Now you need the baptism of the Holy Ghost to operate that, which is coming for you. This
Have
is
you
going
been thinking
to,
about that?
This is going to really bless you beyond measure.
Oh, yeah.
Paul called it joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, yeah. Some people bawl, some laugh, some dance all over the place. This is nuts. And as I said, the Methodist minister in Marion had the Holy Ghost. When we went there, he pulled me in the office and said, I want you to know I got the same experience you do. And I'm like, do you tell it to your congregation? He goes, oh, my board would never allow that. Time to hit the sidewalk when the board don't allow you to do what the word tells you to do.
He did share it in Haiti though with us. He shared it in Haiti with a lot of us.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Oh, you know?
You understand where it's...
Well, here's a... Oh, no, I thought you meant Mike Morgan.
No, I meant Stan Wilson.
I don't know.
He's since passed away, but he was the pastor of the Methodist Church of Marion when we started our church there in 96. Yeah. Okay, so let's get back here now to mission statement. Definition number one, a mission statement is defined as an action-based statement that declares the purpose of an organization and how they serve their customers. This sometimes includes a description of the company. Anybody who's got their head on straight, if you're going to run a business, you have a mission statement.
Yeah. Well, you have to have a focus.
You do.
If you don't know where you're going, you're not going to go though.
You do.
You're just going to flow.
And the reason I've included three definitions from the internet is each one adds something the other didn't.
Okay.
All right. Mission number two. A mission statement defines what line of business a company is in and why it exists, or what purpose it serves. Every company should have a mission statement. Number three, a mission typically addresses what the company does and how and why it does it. It may also include a statement of values and ethics. Now Luke wrote the Gospel of Luke, but he also wrote the book of Acts, and Luke, setting the tone for the entire rest of the New Testament, wrote a mission statement, and it's included in Acts chapter 1, verse 8.
Amen.
This is the mission statement for the entire rest of the New Testament. And Acts 1, 8 reads, but you shall receive power. That word power is the Greek word dunamis, which is where you get the word dynamite. It means miraculous working power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be martus. The word is witnesses in the English. It's the Greek word martus, and that actually is where you get the word martyr from. It is someone that lays down their life for a cause. In other words, my life's no longer my personal life. It's now spent for the cause. Hallelujah. He doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to go out here and be stripped naked, flayed alive, and crucified out here by the road, but he does mean that you're going to lay your life down for the cause of Jesus Christ. My life no longer belongs to me. I can't just decide, oh, I think I'm going to take up a new occupation. I pray about it first and see if the Lord tells me to do that. I can't just decide I'm going to move to Missouri. The Lord says, no, you're going to move to Iowa. Why can he do that? Because my life doesn't belong to me anymore. It belongs to him. And if I'm going to lay down my life for the cause of the gospel, I'm going to do what the master says, I'm going to do it how the master says, and I'm going to do it where the master says. Somebody
right.
Said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
So the purpose. Now, it doesn't say scripture reference on your sheet. It does on mine. We're going to go to 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3. Because we're talking about the purpose. Somebody said the purpose. purpose.
For purpose.
Say it again.
For purpose.
Why are we doing what we're doing?
The purpose.
The purpose. And the purpose is because of 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3. That simply reads, I'm waiting until you're getting there. 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians comes right after 1 Corinthians. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, Corinthians. Hallelujah. Right after Romans. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 3 says, if our gospel, whose gospel?
Ours.
Our gospel. Who do we get it from? We got it from the apostles.
That's right.
Who'd they get it from?
Jesus
Christ himself.
Yep.
Jesus said, search the scriptures. In them you think you have eternal life, but they are they which testify of me. If you don't read Jesus Christ, you haven't read it right.
Yep. Amen. Amen.
If Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, the gospel that I preached unto you is that which I also received. How our Lord Jesus Christ was crucified, dead, and buried, and rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. And he was seen of over 500 at once. What are you saying, Paul? The gospel is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ as payment for the penalty that I should have to pay.
Yes.
What's the gospel?
Death, burial, resurrection.
Okay, to all you geniuses, what's the gospel? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. How do you apply that to your life?
Repentance, baptism in Jesus' name, yeah. Holy Ghost and filling.
Death, burial, resurrection.
No.
Spirit of resurrection, baptism of the
baptism
Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
Burial, every grave has a name. Name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So if our gospel is hid, it is hid to who?
Lost.
If you don't have our gospel, they're lost. Let me tell you what. Does anybody love anybody outside this truth? You got anybody you care about?
Yeah.
That has not obeyed Acts 2:38. Does anybody? They're lost.
Yeah.
Do you know what that means for them?
Yeah.
No. Anybody got any? There's no second guess, pal. There's only two destinations. There is no purgatory. It's either heaven or hell. And hell gets dumped into the lake of fire. If you think hell's bad, hell's only the county jail. When you get arraigned before the judge, you're sent to the penitentiary, and that's the lake of fire, and that's worse than hell. Let me tell you something. When you die, only your body dies. You are conscious. You get yanked out of this clay tube. We put the clay tube in the ground, or we burn it up and put it into a little box and scatter it somewhere. But the real you, you're still conscious. Hallelujah. The rich man was in hell, and Lazarus was in Abraham's bosom. Jesus didn't say a certain man. He said there was a rich man, and he named the guy Lazarus. That means this is a real deal, folks. This wasn't a parable. This was a true story. Jesus knew about it. I'm telling you what. The Bible said of Jesus Christ that he descended into hell and he preached unto the spirits in prison. Here come the judge. He walked down there and he said, now I'm telling you all, I created this. And you rebelled. And I sent you a preacher, and you wouldn't listen. And I sent a flood, and here you are today. I tell you what, boy, they got preached that good. And he came up out of that tomb in 3 days. Woo! I tell you what, you never saw like what come busting out of that tomb that Sunday morning. It was glorious. And those apostles, those chickens that all ran and got inside a place and sat there with their knees knocking and the doors closed, is the same group that stood up on the day of Pentecost and preached out loud, because after the Holy Ghost hit them, they became something else. They got power. Man, ever anybody move aside. These guys had power like you've never seen before.
Boldness.
Hallelujah. They had boldness.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you why. Because the heartbeat of God is that all should come to repentance, that no one should be lost.
That's right. That's the will of God. Yeah.
How are they going to know? Some of them are locked up out here in false doctrine. Some of them are religious, but they're not saved. How are you going to get through to them? I'll tell you how you better get through to them. Psalm 127 says, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it.
Yep.
So God in me had better do the work and not me. That means I need to have my life and my attitude and my mouth in such a fashion that what comes out, what meets you, is the Spirit of God protruding from me or protruding through me. Now it's going to come with a Krog flavor because I'm Krog. All right? When Crystal gets the Holy Ghost, look out, man. It's going to come with a Crystal flavor, and it's going to be good. Hallelujah. Genie got it, and it comes with a Genie flavor, and that's good.
That's good.
Hallelujah. Everybody in here that has the Holy Ghost, it comes through the flavor of you, but it better be Jesus Christ they meet. Hallelujah. Why? Because Jesus is the voice that somebody is dying to hear down at the maddening ground.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
somebody that's down at their bedside at night, but is there anything more to this life? The Spirit in me rises up and says, yes, there's something more.
Yeah, there's
more. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I got it. The purpose is to promote and build the kingdom of God. 2 Corinthians 5:19 said it this way, we are ambassadors for Jesus Christ, as if Christ himself did beseech
you, in
place of us, be you reconciled to God. How do you get reconciled to God? If any man be in Christ, not believer. Believer's a wonderful beginning. I never step on where somebody's at. I have respect for a Catholic priest, but he's not saved. You understand? He has to come into the gospel that the apostles preached. That Roman Catholic priest needs to obey what the first pope preached. Repent, be baptized by immersion in the name of Jesus Christ for remission of sins, receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, speaking with other tongues. That is the salvation message. And that will only get you in. That won't get you home. You better be Spirit-led after you get Spirit-filled.
Yep.
Hallelujah. Because as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Romans 8, what is it, 14?
I'll take your word for it.
No, that's just off the top of my head. The purpose is to recruit and promote citizenship.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I am an ambassador for His Imperial Majesty, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Woo!
I represent the fatherland for standing me. I am sending you to a wonderful country, a wonderful place. We are offering citizenship. Hallelujah. The streets are golden. The gates are pearly. Hallelujah. The king is a glorious, wonderful potentate. You couldn't have a better ruler. He's not Democrat. He's not Republican. He is the Lord God Almighty. He created all things. He existed before all things. Hallelujah. And he is the promoter and giver of life. It is wonderful. You've got to come to my fatherland. Hallelujah. Oh, come on. Sign up. Sign up with citizenship.
Yes.
Hallelujah. 3-step process.
Yes,
hallelujah.
God, hallelujah.
Luke 16, verse 16. Matthew, Mark, Luke. They were on that sheet.
No, they were not.
Yeah, they were.
No, they were not.
The law and the prophets were until John.
Where are you?
Luke 16:16.
Okay.
In the book 16:16.
Okay, keep
going. The law and the prophets were until John. What does that mean? That means the Old Testament ceased with John. John the Baptist was the last Old Testament prophet. Everybody said Old Testament.
Old Testament.
John the Baptist was an Old Testament prophet preparing the way for the Messiah of the New Testament. Jesus said, there's not a man greater born of women other than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that's least in the kingdom is greater than he. Why? Because the New Testament kingdom was Spirit-filled, Jesus' name baptized folks, and John the Baptist did not have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now, the Bible says he was filled with the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. That was an Old Testament prophet's anointing.
It was. Yes, it was.
That wasn't New Testament Holy Ghost salvation. And later on, the Bible says the Spirit was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. So you know that what John had was not the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I give you Bible, boy, turn you not. All right, here we go. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and everybody can just fall right in. You can slide in. Every man does what? Let's get back to Luke 16:16.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so what?
The law and the prophets were until John.
Presses into it.
Every man does what? Presses into it.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to press in the Spirit. You got to wrestle like Jacob and go, I'm not letting you go till you bless me. You got to decide, man, I'm getting a hold of you and I ain't letting go till you get a hold of me. Hallelujah. Somebody say, praise the Lord. How do they serve their customers? Well, the first thing I'm going to do to serve my customers is I'm going to introduce them to the King. Because
yeah.
He's this really wonderful guy. Let's go to John 14. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John 14. Beginning with verse 16. Jesus said he was going to talk to the Spirit. He was going to talk to Dad. And he shall give you another comforter. See, Jesus was there in person. They couldn't have the baptism of the Holy Ghost as long as Jesus was standing there.
Right.
Why? Because the Holy Ghost was in Jesus.
Right.
He had to go away in order for everybody else to get some.
Yeah.
Why? Because there's only one. They're not three.
Mm-hmm.
Praise
the
Lord.
He is.
I'll pray the Father and He'll give you another comforter that He can abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive. Because it doesn't see Him and neither does it know Him. But you know Him. Because He dwells with you and shall be in you. And then He clarifies the whole thing in verse 18 by saying, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. You mean the guy that spoke and said, let there be light, is the Spirit that I received? That's exactly what I'm saying. Creator God is in you. You know, in Ephesians it says there's one God and Father of all, who's above all and through all and in you all.
Yep.
And yet, the same guy that wrote that scripture said in Colossians 1:27, Christ in you is the hope of glory.
Well, verse 20 says it. He says, that that day you should know that I am in the Father, you
Father
and
me,
I in you.
I in you.
Well, the only way to be in us is through the Spirit.
Well, and look at verse 26, by the way. The Holy Ghost does have a name.
Yeah.
Shall we look at the name of the Holy Ghost?
Comforter.
But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in what?
My name.
Now, the last time I looked, if somebody came in somebody's name, that's who they was.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
So what's the name of the Holy Ghost?
Jesus.
Jesus. And He shall do what? Teach you all things. See, this is the wonderful thing about letting the Spirit operate through you,
yeah.
Is the Holy Ghost will teach you things.
Right. Amen.
The Holy Ghost will speak to you. The Holy Ghost will lead you.
Yeah.
Some of us get prophetic things that helps the rest of us sometimes. Hallelujah.
Yeah. Yeah.
We get a little numb and dumb and the Lord speaks. So wake up. Get your feet on the path. Hallelujah. So I'm going to introduce them to the King and then I'm going to teach them kingdom values and requirements. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 6.
Hallelujah.
Well, I'm going to do what I want to do. No, I wouldn't if I were you. You know, Jonah said, I'll do what I want to do. Mm-hmm. Lord said, you go over here. And he goes, nope, I'm not going there. I'm going this way.
Yeah.
Well,
it didn't work out.
The Lord sent a storm. Uh-huh. Yep. Oh, yeah. Hey, Jonah, buddy, how long can you tread water? Bloop. Yep. Over he goes.
Yep.
And then he got swallowed by something smelling real neat. Got swallowed by a fish, the Bible says. And he got puked out 3 days later. Boom. And guess where he got puked out? Boom. Right back to where he should have been, to where he should have been going.
That's right.
Oh. You think, you think your life's your own? You better guess if you think your life's your own. The Apostle Paul says your life's not your own. You bought with a price. Let's go here to 2 Corinthians 6:14. Don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Listen. Don't you marry nobody that ain't Acts 2:38.
Yeah.
They're not a one God, Jesus name baptized, Holy Ghost filled believer. They're unavailable to you. All right? Unless they convert. What fellowship does righteousness have with unrighteousness? What communion does light have with darkness? Well, obviously none. What concord does Christ have with Belial? What part does he that believes have with an infidel? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? Because you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, I will walk in them, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Because of that, come out from among them and be you separate, says the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I'll receive you, and I'll be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. And having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Hallelujah! Somebody said, praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah! I belong to Jesus. You know these people that wear a shirt that says property of Gold's Gym? Property of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That's the way it goes, you know. So, number three, what the company does and how it does it. Well, for one, we build up the kingdom of light and tear down the kingdom of darkness. Luke 11:2.
Oh my God, hallelujah.
Yeah. He said, when you pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, cherished, revered, respected, holy is your name. Your kingdom, not mine. Your kingdom come. Your will, not mine, be done. Now, how am I going to do somebody's will if I don't know what that will is?
Right.
That means I better pray and listen up, right?
Yeah.
Huh? Somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So if I'm going to tear down the kingdom of darkness, that means I need to be led by the Spirit of light.
Right.
And I need to design in my mind and my heart His kingdom, not mine. Right. His 501c3, not mine. His 401k, not mine. There were a couple of occupations that I chose for myself that the Lord said, nope. Well, you see, preacher don't pay too well when you start churches, so this wasn't my first choice.
One of them was the trees, right?
No. One of them was water, running a water plant, running the water tower and the wastewater plant in the town. One of those was to be an electronic technician. And another one was welding. I was in welding. But every time I got a job welding, I end up getting laid off. Now, why is that? Because you ain't supposed to be doing that. You're supposed to be doing this.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir?
Yep.
Gotcha.
Amen.
The operation of the Spirit as described in the gifts and various ministries of that body found in Ephesians 4, beginning in verse 15. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, Corinthians, go eat popcorn, Galatians, Ephesians.
When did you decide to become a preacher? As a young man?
He called me immediately. When I came, well, first off, I had a collision with God in 1980. Flew over the handlebars of my motorcycle at 85 miles an hour, rolled through the ditch, stone drunk, stood up and said, God, life stinks, I'm what now? I'm getting out. If there's anything better, you need to tell me. So 4 days later, he sent in a little ambassador, a little female about this high, and she invited me to church. And I came to church. Thought it was a Barnum and Bailey three-ring circus. That was Monday night. Tuesday night, I went back for a second round, and something landed on me. All the way home, that girl's mother told me I needed to be baptized in Jesus' name. I said, prove it to me. She proved it to me biblically. She was right. Now I was scared spitless. So I got baptized in Jesus' name that Saturday, and as soon as I got baptized, he started calling me to preach. And I was like, that was my grandfather and my uncle. That ain't me. Yeah, well, God knows how to nail your Nikes right to the floor. So. I would be sleeping, and I would hear talking and laughing, and I would wake up and all over, and I'd see a kind of an old cameo over here, me standing by in a pulpit and a church full of people. And I'd go, you can ask Bailey. I couldn't give a speech while in English class in front of six kids, you know, I mean. See, the Holy Ghost makes you able to do things that you couldn't do before. Hallelujah. Oh, the Holy Ghost will set your feet to dancing. Ephesians 4:15 tells me that the body of Christ should be speaking the truth in love. Now, I've known folks that speak the truth, but it ain't coming out of love. We need to speak the truth out of concern for somebody else's outcome. Amen? Hallelujah. That's the truth. Speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, who happens to be Jesus Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which, what? Every joint supplied. Name me the saint that is not needed. Yeah. You can't. By that which every single joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of some parts. Every part makes increase to the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Now here you go. Love is exceedingly addictive. We get together and have potluck because we're a great family. We are. We're the best thing going. Yeah. We're the best thing Central City's ever seen or ever will see. We get together, we like each other's company, we have fun, we have the Holy Ghost, we've got the truth, and we got good food too. And we sit down and we have excellent fellowship. Now I'm going to tell you what, if somebody walked in, they're going to be jealous if they got a half a brain. We got it going on. Not only a dozen of us here, but then Jesus only had 12 to start out with. Right? Hallelujah. God himself only had two in the garden. So we're doing all right. Hallelujah. We're doing all right. And we got God. We got the stuff going on, man. When Gabriel blows that horn, I'm headed homeward. Hallelujah. I got the battery pack. Praise God. So here we are. But each joint supplies. She's got gifts that I ain't got. I got gifts she ain't got. Got gifts that some of the rest of us don't have. And what we do is all of us work together. Well, how do you explain that, preacher? Well, it's like this. How many uses a computer? I know you do. Who else does?
I use it. My phone is a computer.
Okay. So let's say you get your hand caught in a saw and you lose these three fingers. How are you going to do typing on the computer?
Yeah,
you
get voice
activation.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
Well, I ain't playing the 12 string no more. I promise you that.
Oh, you could learn on the other hand.
There you go.
Capital alert on the other hand, voice activation.
Well, I couldn't hold the pick with these two, I suppose.
Yep.
But I wouldn't be able to finger pick, which is more what I do most of the time. So, here we are. Keyboard player would really be stuck. The point is, you need each and every member. You can't put that power grip on a hammer without those three. As a matter of fact, this one really adds the grip. That little bitty finger adds the stability of the power grip. When you grab a pair of pliers, leave your little finger out of it sometime and see what kind of power you can put on that bench. You put that little pinky in there, man, you've got a grip. That little bitty finger on the end of the hand that don't look too awful significant ain't a lot by itself, but when it's with the others. It's kind of like playing Red Rover, you know? Man, I mean, you strengthen the link, okay? What are you trying to say, Krog? I'm trying to say that God puts you in the body, and there ain't one of them that God puts in that you don't need. You need every single one of them. Even the ones you don't like so well.
Yeah. Oh, preacher's done that one. All right, here we are.
The operation of the gifts is described in 1 Corinthians 12. It's described in Ephesians. It's described in Ephesians 6. It's everywhere. All through the book. The whole book of Acts, they operated in the spiritual gifts. What does that mean? Well, really, it means that they came to know the voice of the Holy Ghost. So first they got baptized with the Holy Ghost and spoke in tongues, and then they got led of the Holy Ghost after they got filled. You see. Now here's the deal, is that a lot of apostolics get to the point where they've obeyed Acts 2:38, and then they figure I'm saved and they sit down. Listen, you ever had your leg go to sleep on you? You go to stand up, and it ain't quite working so good, you know? Any member that's asleep ain't doing anybody any good.
Right, amen. That's right.
You ain't doing any good. And the feeling's done going out of it, and it's tingling, and now it's giving the whole body a fit because the whole body's trying to wake it up. Wake up! Amen? We need to give up the program here. The life of saints, or the life of witnesses, is how, everybody said how, they live out and share their testimony to promote the kingdom. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 2. Now we were at 2 Corinthians 4, now we're going to go to chapter 3. The Apostle Paul said, you are our epistle. What's an epistle? It's a letter written to the body of Christ somewhere that is opened, known, and read of all men. See, witness isn't something I do, it's something I am. I might not go in and grab the guy up here at the Jack and Jill grocery store and tell him Acts 2:38 behind the counter. Of course, if you know me, I probably will sooner or later, but the chances are I probably am not going to go that far. But when he meets me, he's going to see that I'm a spirit-filled Christian by how I live, by what I don't say, by what I do say, by what I laugh at and what I don't laugh. He's going to look at me by what I buy and what I do not buy. Because how I live my life is a witness. You know, you are the only Bible some people will ever read. So what are they reading? Are they reading, or are they reading, well, bless the Lord. No. forget.
When he did that, he made me think of a wet willy.
Well, I'm just getting the connection good so that I can buzz, you know. The mission statement is, you shall receive power.
Yeah.
You shall receive the ability after the Holy Ghost comes upon you to be able to lay your personal life down and be a witness for the kingdom. That's the mission statement for the rest of the book. So what do people see when they see us? What do they hear when they hear us?
Depends on how
it
makes me mad.
So
different strokes.
Yeah. Judy's little pet names for Ray.
Yeah.
She had me pink and laughing the other day.
Ray's God.
Oh, hallelujah. What is the world going to hear, and when are they going to hear it? Can Jesus walk along somebody, send an angel, thump them upside the head and go, now look at that guy. See that guy Henderson over there? He acts like a Christian. He doesn't do things that non-Christians do. Why don't you go ask him what he believes? Can God do that? Can God do that with us?
Sure.
Wow! Do they know enough of the truth to be able to tell them how to get saved? Do we know enough of the truth to demonstrate it before them? Hallelujah. Are you enough led of the Spirit that you can be tuned in?
That's it. That's important.
Yeah.
Lonnie Bowman. Lonnie Treadway. Pastor of United Pentecostal Church in Beaumont, Texas. Would go to the church every day, and down to the office, and he would study, and he would pray, and then he would go home. His house was, oh, I don't know, 14, 15 blocks from the church, and he always went the same way. And on the way home today, he gets in his car in the parking lot, and notices he needs gas. So he's going to go 4 blocks down the street to whatever station he's going to get gas. And as he puts the car in reverse, begins to back out of the parking lot, the Holy Ghost says, no, you're going to go a different way today. You're going to go 4 streets down. And the thought, you don't really register right away that it's the Holy Ghost. You know? Well, that's dumb. I don't go that way. I go this way. This is the shortest route home. And he starts to go that way home. You need to go 4 streets over. And the nagging thought keeps hitting him. You need to go 4 streets over. So he gets down 2 blocks. Oh, all right. So he turns left. He goes 4 streets over. Turns right and goes down. Oh, there's a come and go gas station. I'll get gas. So he pulls in and gets his gas. Walks into the guy behind the counter and he's getting ready to pay because he didn't pay at the pump. He goes in and he's going to pay. He looks at the guy behind the counter and he goes, do you receive the Holy Ghost since you believe? She goes, no, but I want it. He reaches his hand across the counter and boom, speaking in tongues right behind the cash register. Well, the assistant come out of the cooler just then, put the two-wheeler down, and goes, what's this going on? He goes, hush, she just received the Holy Ghost. She goes, well, I want it. Boom, speaking in tongues. Two of them now. Here over here by the chips, Mr. Off-Duty Cop. Is that for everybody? Can I have it? Yeah. Three people speaking in tongues because he heard the voice and went 4 blocks this way and 2 blocks that way and went to a different gas station today and had the gumption to ask if you received the Holy Ghost in you. See, being Spirit-led is just as important as being Spirit-filled.
Yeah, that's right.
So once I get Spirit-filled, I need to get me my agenda. See, Lonnie had his agenda. I go this way. And I stop at this gas station because this is the shortest route, and I need to get gas. I know this station. I know these folks. No, you're not going that way today. Well, this is the way I go. This is my agenda. What the Holy Ghost has a different agenda than they. You go this way. But, well, fine. And he goes this way. Well, what happens when you get your agenda out of the way and you do the Lord's agenda? Three souls got saved.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Her dad owned a condo in Boca Raton, Florida. Owned Acme Electric Company. So we would go down there for vacation every now and then. And we went down to the mall, because after all, Pentecost was always going to the mall, right? And there was a Traffic's shoe store there, T-R-A-F-F-I-X. And they sell cheap shoes. This was really neat. I got a pair of patent leather wingtips down there for like $15. They're great. And I went into this store, and a little Mexican gal behind the counter. Oh, Spanish gal. Yo tengo un Santa Biblia? No, I don't have a Bible. Oh, you do speak English. Okay. And all I knew, there was something up when you guys walked in. She said, I just saw this light. I just knew there was something about you guys. I said, well, have you ever heard of the baptism of the Holy Ghost? No. I said, well, that's where the Spirit of God, you get filled with the Spirit of God and you'll speak in a heavenly language. I said, would you like that? Yeah. Linda. Girl wants Holy Ghost. Oof, she's speaking in tongues right there by the counter. Same thing happened to us again when we went to Steamboat Arabia Museum in Kansas City. We were with the Millers, and my wife and the two Millers, we walked out of the hotel room. They walked down to get in the elevator, and I'm the last one out, you know, and I shut the door, and I went, poof, and I walk into a wall of Holy Ghost. I mean, wow, a lot of Holy Ghost, you know. I got tears coming down my eyes. And, what, Lord? You didn't tell me anything. Okay, something's up. I walk in the elevator, I told the wife, man, I just walked into the wall of Holy Ghost. What about? I don't know. So we go downstairs, we come in the lobby, and I look around. Well, there's only one old lady over there getting cereal. That ain't it. So we get in the car, we go to Steamboat Arabia Museum, and my wife and Sister Miller go into the store, and they're getting the tickets, and Lauren and I go over here, and we're looking at the map. You know, they got laid out the map and where they found the steamboat and all of this stuff and how they raised it. And there's two women and a man, and these are all Hispanics, and they got a couple little kids with them. And so I start talking with them, and I said, yeah, we're Spirit-filled. Have you ever heard of that? Oh, no. Well, one gal heard of it, but she didn't have anything. So about that time, the women show up, and I told my wife, I said, these two ladies want the Holy Ghost. Poof, she prays with them, and they both get the Holy Ghost. Because they come standing right there. Now, there's a whole store of people kind of just going around.
They actually
might be a blessing. Yeah, they're just kind of, I don't know what's going on. This, you know? I don't care what they think. We're here with two folk receiving the Holy Ghost. And the guy wanted it, but he didn't get it, you know. So we told him where they can go. Well, he's from California. So we told him, well, you know, where you're from, there's this Pentecostal church. You look that up when you get home. You go there. They'll baptize you in Jesus' name. They'll pray with you, and you'll get the Holy Ghost. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Kingdom business. Kingdom agenda. Can God interrupt your agenda? Or are we so bent on what it is we're doing that we're oblivious to what the Holy Ghost might be doing out here? And he might be doing it with scoundrels we don't like. I was one of those scoundrels at one time. Hallelujah, but God did it. So every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, today you got to help me clear my agenda. Hold it loosely, so that you can interrupt my day. Lord, I need to be in communication with you through prayer enough that I know your voice enough that when you speak, I hear you. And I'm willing to step out and obey, Lord. I'm willing to be led. I'm hungry to be led. I'm hungry to see your spirit move. I'm hungry to see you find some soul. Lord God, hallelujah. We're here to promote your kingdom. That's why we're here, Lord. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain. I don't have a program. I don't have a plan, God. Like Carmen said, you're my plan A. I don't have a plan B.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. You're it, God. So I need you to lead and guide my life every day in Jesus' name. Everybody said in Jesus' name?
In Jesus' name.
All right. Hallelujah. You are dismissed today. The fear of the Lord.